Hello and welcome back to the channel. Today we're taking a look at an Orion XT 4.5. It's a 4.5-inch F8 Newtonian reflector on a Dobsonian mount. It's a mount that moves left and right and up and down. It's the baby in the XT line, and it's probably the one you're spending the least amount of time looking at in the Orion catalog. But that would be a mistake. This is a full-fledged member of the XT family, and it's definitely worth your consideration. So if you're not familiar with telescopes, it's actually pretty simple. This is a reflecting telescope that uses a mirror in the back to collect light, in this case about 4.5 inches worth. It sends the light into this angled secondary mirror here, which in turn angles the mirror, the light out into the eyepiece, and this is where you look, and this is how you focus. To change magnifications, you change eyepieces. This one comes with two eyepieces, a 25mm and a 10mm. The 25mm yields around 36 power, and the 10mm somewhere around 90 power. You're going to be spending most of your time using the low power eyepiece. 36 power I find to be a very good low power magnification, especially for beginners. It's a very friendly, forgiving magnification. Things are easy to find, things are easy to track, and it doesn't place a lot of stress on the mount. So just as a comparison, here it is next to an XT8. This is the telescope I keep recommending to people. This is the 8-inch F6 Dobsonian, and you can see the familial resemblance. So the XT8 weighs somewhere around 45, 46 pounds. The 4.5 only weighs around 17.5 pounds. So you could take this thing almost anywhere, and no matter how small your vehicle is. So they are similar, but for some reason the 4.5 has a few different design features than the rest of them. And this isn't serious, but I thought it was interesting to point this stuff out. So first of all, you'll notice on the XT8 and all of the other scopes in the XT line, the bearings are somewhere near the center of gravity. In other words, there's about as much weight forward of the bearings as there is on the other side of the bearing. And in fact, I've even done this. You can remove one of the springs if you don't need a lot of this tension, and this still holds. So on the XT 4.5, this, however, is not true. You'll notice that the bearings are moved very far back on the tube to the point where this is now unbalanced without the springs. And I know why they did this. They did this to get the height of the telescope down, because this is a telescope that is often cited as ideal for children to learn on. They want to get this telescope down as much as possible. I have to be careful here. If you do remove this spring, it can actually do this, and it'll start to nosedive on you. So you, in this case, you actually do need both springs on there. In every other XT Dob, the spring is at the center of the bearing, and where you clamp the spring down is directly below the bearing. That's not the case here. It's a little bit off center here, and it's towards the back. So I'm not really sure why I did that. You'll see this knob here sort of do this dance as I move this thing around. But you'd think they would just design one XT and then just scale the thing up or down depending on what size they wanted. Okay, so how does it perform? Well, the first thing you're gonna have to do is find something to set it on. Yes, as with many of these beginner telescopes, you have to find some sturdy surface to get it up to the height where an adult can look at it. So this is a rolling cart that I have, and I used to be able to give a link out to where you can get one of these, because it's unusually sturdy for something like this. You really need something that's strong and won't move around on you. But the big box stores that used to carry this thing, they don't make it anymore. So I'm not quite sure what your solution's going to be. I've seen people take a storage tub, a plastic storage tub, you know, shore up the edges and put a telescope on it. I've seen other solutions as well, including a custom Dob base that I've seen in the Orion catalog. I like that thing a lot, but I've always been suspicious of why does that thing cost so much? But anyhow, this particular platform, it doesn't actually look right, because two of the feet actually hang off the edges and the third one's here. I didn't like this at first because it looks kind of odd. The feet are hanging off the edges. But then I realized this is actually more stable. It's going to be much more difficult to push this thing off in the dark. So again, you do need to find something to set it on. It is going to be a concern of yours. You can set it down on the ground and kneel down, and I did this for my initial testing, but you're going to get tired of that after only a few minutes. Okay, so I did a review of this thing for Scope Reviews back in 2013, and back then I declared that I liked it a lot. I even said at the end of the review that this was probably my favorite in the entire XT line. Yeah, in hindsight, that's probably a little bit of a strong statement, but there's a kind of undeniable charm about this thing. So I've had it out the past few nights, and it's been really good. Saturn and Jupiter are sinking towards the west, but still look very good. At the 10 millimeter eyepiece at 90 power is okay. The problem is it's getting a little bit small and squinty, and the eye relief is getting a little bit short, but you can see cloud belts on Jupiter, four moons, the rings of Saturn also, no problem. Put better eyepieces in here. I have an 11 millimeter Nagler type 6. It works really well on this telescope. I don't know how many people are going to use a $300 eyepiece in a $279 telescope, but if you have good eyepieces, this can make use of them. On double stars, it's really good. Albireo is a nice clean split, orange and blue components. A tighter pair, Eta Cassiopeia, also looks very good with that blood wine secondary very close to the primary component. On deep sky, this thing works really well. It's late fall, early winter right now, and the objects up there that you can see are numerous. I had no problem looking at the Pleiades, the Andromeda Galaxy, the three clusters in Auriga, M37, M36, and M38. The Orion Nebula later on in the evening looks really good in the 25 millimeter eyepiece. NGC 457, the Owl cluster, looks terrific also. And I'll tell you what, on good nights, I could even see M33. That's the low contrast galaxy in Triangulum that gives a lot of people some trouble. Okay, so are there any drawbacks? Well, of course, it's a sub-$300 telescope, and nothing in this price range is going to be perfect. So on this model, there are three common criticisms that are leveled against it. First of all, and the most important, is the fact that for an adult, you are going to have to find something to set it on. There's no set solution to this. It's something you're going to have to come up with yourself. And I said before, you can kneel on the ground and use it, but you're going to get tired of doing that. Second of all is this plastic focuser. And I've harped on this thing before. I don't know what to do about this. I'm starting to see this kind of plastic focuser on not only low-range models, they're starting to creep up into the mid-range models as well. I think it's something we're just going to have to live with and manage for a while. So when you're transporting this thing around, be sure when you're in a doorway or putting it in the trunk of your car that you don't bump that. Replacement parts are getting very difficult to find. The third thing is that the mirror is not a parabola, it is a sphere. And some people will worry about this, and I'm telling you, because the telescope is operating at f8, you're not gonna notice any difference. It's fine. Again, all of the things that I saw with the detail on the planets, the contrast on M33 and deep sky, you're not going to notice any difference practically. If you're a real geek and you like to do the star test, you know, where you rack the focuser in and out and you look at the patterns, yes, it's going to appear to be undercorrected. A spherical mirror is an undercorrected mirror. They didn't quite take out enough material, but look, trust me, it's not a big deal. Don't worry about it. So we're here at one of my favorite observing sites, and as you can see, I removed the optical tube from the Dobb base and placed it on an equatorial mount. Now you can do this, but your main challenge is going to be finding rings or a cradle like this one to place it on. I went over to Scope Wizard's house and he's got a bunch of these 114 millimeter rings that just happened to fit this tube, so it was lucky. Put it on a Vixen compatible plate, put it on the mount, and we have full functionality with tracking and with GoTo. So some people ask me, what is the difference between light gathering between a 4.5 inch, a 6 inch, and an 8 inch? And I'm very often reluctant to do this comparison because your mileage not only may vary, it will vary. It depends on your seeing conditions, your skill level, and any number of factors. But maybe this will be useful to you. I had a 4.5, a 6, and an 8-inch out here on everybody's favorite pair of galaxies, M81 and M82. And I sort of did this by feel. This is what I came up with, and perhaps this will be useful to you. I also took the opportunity to use my planetary imagers in this telescope. Here is a picture of the moon that I took. It's a composite of three individual images stitched together. That looks pretty good. I also got this image of Jupiter, and I'm not sure what YouTube compression is doing to the video that you're looking at, but you can just barely see at 10 p.m. a tiny little black dot there. That is a shadow transit that is leaving the surface of the planet. Okay, so here we have the Orion XT 4.5 with some other commonly recommended beginner telescopes, all under $300 or so. We have the SkyWatcher Heritage 150P. You saw me do a review on this earlier, but this is a 6-inch, and the innovation here is that it's a collapsible design. It collapses off down to almost nothing. If this is too much for you, they do make a 5-inch model that is a little bit cheaper. Here's the Orion Starblast that you see recommended all the time. This is a 4.5-inch tabletop reflector, shorter focal length than this one, a little bit cheaper, a little bit smaller, a little bit lighter. And we have the trusty Orion Short Tube 80 and its clones. It's an 80mm f5 refractor. You do need a mount for this one. So take a look at all of these beginner telescopes and what do they all have in common? They all have mount issues. Beginning telescopes need good mounts, either something to set it on or a tripod or a solid mount. It's almost inevitable when you buy something cheap that the problems you have tend not to be optical, but they are often mechanical. It's focusers, it's mounts, it's tripods, it's finding something to set them on. So there you have it, a look at the Orion XT 4.5, a 4.5-inch f8 reflector on a Dobsonian mount. In my written 2013 review, I gave it a thumbs up. I've also mentioned it a couple of times on these videos as a good alternative for beginners. You know, it's been a while since I've seen one of these, and I wanted to make sure that my impressions were still the same. You know, I bought this thing off Craigslist not long ago. I've been praising this thing both in print and in these videos, but I have to admit, it's been a couple of years since I've seen one of these. I wasn't disappointed. I think my original intention was to buy it, use it for a while, do this review, and then sell it off. But you know what? It's so interesting, so charming, and so friendly to use. I think I just may keep it. Thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.